Hi there. This is in the second of my short series of tutorials showing how to create this scene with the liquid and the toast and so on. Today we're going to cover creating the plate, the toast and the teaspoon here, the newspaper as well if we have time. The tea and the liquid we'll do in another tutorial. So you can see we've got the cup here from the previous tutorial and we're going to use the saucer as the basis for the plate. Those are my lights either side there. So to start with, I'm going to make a duplicate of the saucer and then we will go to modify that slightly. What we'll do is we'll select the inner part of the saucer and then we'll expand that. Using C is a way to select. It gives you a circular selection area, and certainly with circular things, it's a very quick way to select the vertices you want. And then we can just scale those out. We're trying to preserve that little dip in the middle. I missed a couple of vertices there. On the other side, then we just select those and we should be off. Scaling that up with S, but not scaling on the Z axis. We don't want to thicken the plate up. And you can see that's working. We just adjust it to where we think it needs to be. Looks a bit like a dish at the moment, so we need to lift it up. And we need to expand that, the flat area in the middle now. So just selecting that, scaling it up without scaling on the Z axis, so that's scale, and then Shift Y. You can see that's expanded that out. The proportions aren't quite right, so Control Plus to expand out slightly, and then scale again outward. We've missed some vertices there, so add those, and then scaling out again. S and Shift Z, and lift it up a bit so it's less like a dish and more like a plate. Obviously you can spend more time on this when you're doing it yourself, as I did the first time. And lifting it up again. So that'll do for the plate. You can see it's just a change of proportions to change from the saucer to the plate, and then just change the size of it to an appropriate size. And looking at a view similar to that I used in the rendered image, just getting the height right. And we've already got the textures on there, so that was time saved. These little objects are my lights. I'll just take those out so you can see better. And we can see that the next thing we're going to make is this spoon. Spoon's quite a complex object, but it shouldn't be too difficult. So I go to a new layer so there's nothing to interfere. And what I want to do first of all is bring up an image to help me trace that spoon. So we use the menu on the right hand side, and as you can see there's the background images. So what we need to do is tick background images and then add an image. In my textures, there you can see at the bottom there, the spoons. I'll just select the spoon image, open that, and you can't see it at first because you need to be in orthographic. If you're off axis at all, if you're at any sort of funny angle, the image will disappear. You need to press 7 or 1 or 3 on the numpad in order to be able to see an image when you're using it as a background image. The spoon is slightly rotated, which means I'm just going to have to use my eye just to get the general proportions right, but it's not going to be too much of a problem. So to start with, I'm going to use a Bezier curve because it will help me get the bowl of the spoon, and I'm going to use the edge of the spoon as the guide. There's other ways of doing it. I could have just used a sphere and cut away the parts that I don't want, but this worked for me and it seemed to give a reasonably good result. We use curve and Bezier. And then I just rotate that through 180, and then we'll move it roughly where we want it and go into edit mode and just move the two points that you get to roughly where I think they need to be. Now you can just go ahead and add lots of points, but you might almost just as well trace the edge if you're going to do that. Using the Bezier curve can give you a nicer and even more controllable edge. By using the little handles either side of the curve, that'll help me to control where that curve is. It's not going to 100% match the spoon, but it's going to get reasonably close. I need to make sure that I've got a little open bit at the end in order to give me some vertices to build the handle of the spoon. And what we're going to do is we're going to use the spin function in order to build the rest of the spoon once I've got the edge right. So I'm just playing around a little bit here just to get as close as I can to the shape of the spoon. And then we'll turn this into a mesh and spin it to give us all the intervening vertices. Again, I'm spending probably more time on this than I should for a tutorial. But obviously you can play around with this for as much as you want. I'm leaving, as I say, a little gap at the edge there just to make sure that I've got some extra vertices to build the handle. It doesn't look too bad there. And what I'll do now is just have a look. I'm going to convert it to a mesh. And now it's something that I can build from. And we'll go into edit mode in a moment, and then we'll be able to spin the object. So we need to make sure we select all the vertices. The spinning will take place around the 3D cursor. So that's why I've placed it where I have, roughly on the center point. You can see it's spinning around the 3D cursor based on the viewpoint. So I need to change view, and I've just noticed that there's a slight angle in the curve that I've built, so I need to flatten that. So there we go. But now I need to just go and check that it hasn't distorted the curve too much. So just reposition that. And then I'll change to side view and spin again. And you can see it's starting to build the curve. It's in the wrong direction, but it doesn't matter. And it's done it at 90 degrees. I'm just accepting the default 9 steps. It doesn't matter too much because I'm going to add a subdivision surface anyway. And that needs to go up to 180. It's not quite aligned correctly, which is why we've got that funny effect there at the tip of the spoon. So I'm just going to correct that by moving around the 3D cursor slightly. And we'll just check it again. Yes, I thought it would do that. Making sure I'm looking at the right side and moving the cursor. And then we can spin it. And you should see that we've got a pretty good effect of the bowl of the spoon. So we'll just rotate that through, just move it around a little bit, and then rotate that through on the x-axis 180 so that it's the right way up, and get it roughly positioned. Most of this is going to have to be by eye now anyway, because the image of the spoon that I'm using is slightly rotated. I'm also going to reduce this now by scaling on the z-axis, just because it's a little bit more like a soup spoon at the moment, and it's a teaspoon we're trying to create. So we're just going to use S and scale on the z-axis just to make it a little shallower. Again, it's just something I'm doing by eye. Generally speaking, that's fine. And these vertices at the end there are the ones I'm going to use to build the handle. However, I know that there will be a lot of little vertices right at that tip because of the way I created this. So I've used C to select them all, and then I'm going to Alt-M and merge at the center. So now that should, I'm just going to check it, but that should have removed them all and created them, merged them all into one vertex, which it has. Now I could build the rest of the spoon by cutting the whole thing in half along the horizontal axis, and then just building half of the spoon and letting a mirror modifier build the rest, and that's a perfectly good way of doing it. I've chosen not to do so at this point, so I'm just going to add a loop to the middle there and give me a center point, because I'm going to need that, and then I'm going to use the knife modifier just to join up that final vertex, which is K for the knife modifier, and then spacebar once you've selected the vertices you want to add. And now I can select that loop of vertices at the end there and start to build the handle. So we just press E to extrude and start to come out. In fact, before I do that, I'm going to just scale up a little bit on that edge there, just to start to give me a sort of gradual change to the handle, and then extruding, pulling it in. Now, obviously, because of the slight twist on the picture here, I'm not going to be faithfully following the line of the handle, but I'll just be using my eye just to get the proportions about right. And that's mostly what you use these sort of images for, unless you're trying to create something that's an exact copy. It's more about just getting the proportions right, because it's very easy to get them completely wrong in a 3D image. So we're coming out here, and then we start to scale up again, extruding and then pulling it out. I'm going to be adding a subdivision surface, so that will certainly take care of most of the sharp edges, which is fine because obviously spoons don't have too many sharp edges. And I'm going to add a couple of loops here, even though it's not strictly, you might think it wasn't strictly necessary, because I want to maintain that sort of lump in the outline. So there's another set of vertices, and then extruding out again, scaling in. Probably going to change the scale of these in a moment, and outward, and so on. And we just carry on like that to the end. And extruding again, taking it in. That's another set of vertices there. Bring them in, and then one more set of vertices, but this time Alt M, and join them at the center. So that's now got the handle. I'm going to just change the proportion slightly. I think we'll make that a little bigger. Add another loop there and scale that up a bit, and add another one in there and scale that up a bit. So this is just really artistic license. Let's scale that one up slightly as well. And the same coming back to these two, taking them out slightly. It's just adding some shape, adding some interest to the form. And doing the same here and here. Okay, now I notice that we've got a very concave shape to the handle, which isn't very accurate to that of a spoon. So I'm going to need to select that and then flatten that out. So just having a look, right, yeah, you can see it's a very rounded shape because of the vertices that I used to create it. So I'm just going to select them all. Out to about there, I think. I don't want to go all the way because I want a slight variation. And there's a couple of extra vertices I need to pick up there. That was C I used to select it. And now I'm going to scale on the Z axis to flatten it out. That's S and then Z. And then lift it up slightly so that we lose that little kink where the handle joins the bowl of the spoon. And you can see that gives a pretty, even before the subsurface goes on, that gives a pretty good representation. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start to select some of the couple of lines of vertices, or three lines of vertices, in order to add some ridges, just to add a little bit of textural interest to the spoon. They're very rarely completely flat. There's usually something going on, whether it's a rim around the edge or whatever. And this is supposed to be a quality spoon, so we need to add something in there. So I've decided, I think, to just have the center line selected and then skip one and have the next lines out. Selecting those and selecting them all the way out so they'll follow the shape of those curves on the outside, but stopping just short of the very end so that they'll flatten as they reach the edge. So don't select the very end vertices. And now all I'm going to do is just lift them up a little bit. Not too much. And obviously you can do this with textures as well, but I'm actually going to add a sort of bump texture as well anyway in a moment. And I'm going to add a slight crease with mean crease as well, just to help to emphasize that slightly. And then we're going to set this to smooth shading. And we're going to add a subdivision surface. So it seems to disappear there pretty much when I add the smooth shading. But once we've added the subsurf modifier, they'll come back again, because now there's enough vertices to support them. That's looking pretty fair as a spoon. Save that. And we need to do something about the texture now. And you can see how it all grades in. I'm also adding a solidify modifier just to give it a little bit of thickness. And you can see the subsurf modifier is handling that nicely as well. So I think that's a pretty realistic representation of a spoon there. And we just need some texture on it now, some material. So there it is. You can see there it is next to the original. It's not bad for a very quick job. And what we'll do now is we'll start to put a little bit of material on it. So the spoon's going to be represented as silver, and metals, unlike non-metallic substances, tend to reflect light and colour it as they reflect it. Silver tends to give off a slightly yellowish-greenish sort of reflection. So what we'll do is we'll add a glossy shader. But before we do that, we're going to unwrap it. And the reason we're unwrapping it, even though we're using a procedural texture to start with, is because we're going to add a bump map to it as well. So because it's a very flat object, I'm just going to start off by unwrapping it from view. So project from view, and there's our spoon. Now I need to call the image up, just making it a bit bigger, of the original spoon, so that I can make sure they line up. So there's our teaspoon. We just need to rescale the proportions on the UV image now, the UV map. And this will need some tweaking anyway. Scaling on the x-axis, basically scaling UV maps, which is what I'm doing now, is the same as working in the 3D view, except there's no z-axis to worry about, so it's just scaling x and y. So just fiddling around with it now, getting the axis right, just getting the proportions right, and I will add a slight rotation on it because the image is slightly rotated too. And I'm going to have to come back to that and tweak it a little bit more in a little bit, but that'll do for now. So now we'll just save that and then add a texture. We put a new texture on it and we'll make it a glossy shader. We need to give it a little bit of colour because it's a metal. Metals colour their reflections. So in this case, we're going to add slightly yellow or greenish, yellow-greenish sort of texture to it. So here we go. We'll try this to start with and give it some sort of colour so that you can see it's textured in the viewport. Try to make them slightly different depending on what they are, and then you'll be able to easily recognise them. And we'll put a little bit of roughness on it at the moment. That'll blur any reflections. So we'll save that. And now we'll go to the rendered view to see what that looks like. I'll just check the number of preview samples and then go into rendered view. So there it is. That's not bad as a first pass for our spoon. You can see the ridges that I put onto it. And you see it's possibly a little too green at the moment, so we'll reduce the level of green in there and go slightly yellower and perhaps brighten it up a little bit. Possibly a little too bright. But that's not bad as a representation of a silver metal object. So we'll now go into the node editor, pulling another window down. We'll be using the node editor quite a bit in this one. Make sure that we've got the material selected. And then what we're going to do is we're going to add a texture. So we'll add an image texture and we will select the spoon texture that we mapped onto. And we'll simply use that initially straight into displacement. Now it's not perfect, but you can certainly see that it starts to add a few more little bits of interest, more reflections and things. We've got a bit of an issue in the bowl of the spoon. Well, you might like some of the mottling effect, the sort of hammered effect from there. But we're going to add a color ramp now so that we can play with what elements of the image act on the bump. And I'm just looking at whether I can reduce some of that hammered effect down there and the lines and things. We're going to have to change the mapping slightly to get rid of those lines. That's where the UV map has gone off the edge, as it were. And we can also invert it by sort of swapping the order of those lines over, and that's quite handy sometimes. It saves you having to put another node in there. So you can see how this sort of selectively alters the image, and we can play around with that and see what we like. So I'll just change a few things here. The actual way it grades between one colour and the other is selected here. I'll try cardinal. If you imagine it's just a curve and this is just selecting it, with constant it just immediately changes from one to the other. So if you wanted very sharp changes, that's what you'd use. Cardinal is the one I use more often than others. And I'm just playing around with it to sort of get something which I think will look okay from a distance. I want relatively rounded sort of effect, so I don't want those two lines too close together. The further apart they are, the more variations in shade that you get, and the position of where they are will determine the thresholds for the bump map coming through. And now I need to make that bump map a little less extreme, so I'll add a math converter, a math node, and we'll change it to multiply. We'll drop that in there. So that's multiplying by 0.5 at the moment, so dropping it down, and it's a bit less extreme. That's not too bad. Just playing around just to get a reasonable level of reflections. We've obviously got a bit of a problem in the bowl of the spoon, so I need to just go into the UV image map again and just alter that. So go into edit mode and we just have a look at the bowl of the spoon so I can see what we're altering. And we need to select that point. We'll try a bit of proportional editing to start with. We'll try scaling that and see how that goes. I'm just basically going to shrink it so it fits within the bowl. And it won't actually change on the rendered image until I come out of edit mode. Just tweaking it around. There you can see it's changed once I've come out of edit mode, but it's not quite right yet. So we'll use box select now, select everything in there, and just scale it in. Just moving it around a little bit and scaling it. Again, you won't see any change till you come out of edit, and there you go. That's not bad. I think it's not perfect, but it's good enough, and certainly good enough for the tutorial. You can play around with it a lot longer, obviously. So we'll go back to 3D view, and that's basically the spoon done. So we'll move that into our other scene, or the main scene, and we'll see how that looks. So M to move it, and there we go. And just alter the scale of it. It's a little bit large at the moment. And drop it down. And here's one of the reasons that we color the objects when we're using cycles in the UE, because that way it's easy to see when you've got one object penetrating another and so on. I'm not going to spend too long getting the angles perfect. If you really wanted to get them exactly right, you could always use physics, of course, but really that's not necessary. This is more certainly not for a still scene like this. I'm just going to get it roughly right. It approximates what I did the first time around. I certainly took a lot longer to do it there. And obviously when you're doing these things, there's a lot of trial and error. Trying things out, see what they look like, try it a different way, and so on. When I first built this scene, I actually just very roughly created a nearly flat spoon just to put it there, just so I could see what the image was going to look like. And it was only later I came back to it and made a better one like this. So we saved that. Bring some lights in and have a look at what it looks like. And we can see there that plate's quite reflective, so we might change that slightly in a moment, but starting to take shape. The colours from the background are showing up in the scene, so we're just going to the China colour there and just put a bit of roughness in there just to reduce those, blur those reflections a little bit. That's better. So I think that's starting to look okay. So back to solid view. And just select the main scene. And we need to add a few more objects now. So we'll come into here. We'll add the plane. And this is going to be our table surface with the mat. We'll just scale that up a little bit. And see where that, how that compares. So we'll drop that down. And scale it up a little bit more. And push it back slightly. Okay, as a flat surface, this is a very easy one to deal with. So we'll just go into edit mode and UV unwrap that. Unwrap project from view bounds. And that's that done. Now we'll add a texture. We'll try a mix shader to start with. And we'll try a combination of a diffuse and a glossy. But it'll mostly be the diffuse texture. And we'll give it a color so that we can see that it's different from the rest in the UE. And now we'll go and add an image texture. I'll open up my textures. And I've got it in materials, I think. And there it is. Open image. And we'll go to rendered view. And we'll see what that looks like. And the lighting isn't set up yet, which is why we're getting some strange little bright spots. But it sort of looks like a shiny table, so I'm not so sure about those reflections yet. I think I'd prefer it as just a simple cloth, which doesn't really have an awful lot of highlights. But before we do anything further there, we'll go into the node editor. Again, you're getting plenty of experience with the node editor here. And there's our image feeding into the diffuse, which feeds into a mix shader, which brings in the glossy, and then that feeds into the material itself, the material output. And the glossy determines how much of one shader and how much of the other. So we're going to get rid of the mix shader and the glossy now, I think, and just put the diffuse straight in. That immediately looks a bit better. And as we often do, I'm going to take the image texture and put that straight into the displacement map. And you can see in certain parts of the image that it's starting to show sort of bumps. Coloured images like this don't always work too well for that, but I think this is okay in this case. It just needs a bit of scaling. So we'll add a math node, change it to multiply, and it's already at 0.5, so it's scaling it down a little bit. We'll try a bit more subtle, and I think that's fine. And that gives you a reasonable representation of a cloth on a table. I'm just going to rotate the teacup so you can see the handle that we put so much work into. And we'll bring the table into the main layer with M. And save that. So I think what we'll do next is we'll add the toast into that plate. So we go to a new layer, and we'll simply add a cube. Toast is fairly straightforward. And we'll bring up the image again at the back. And this time we'll call up an image of the toast that I'm going to use, which I've got under food here. It's that toast there that I used. I'm just going to roughly shape my cube to cover that toast. That's scaled it up. And now I need to, once I've moved it around a little bit, I need to subdivide it. So I'm just going to change the number of subdivisions, the number of cuts here. And then we can start moving the vertices around. You need to bear in mind that this is a 3D cube I'm editing here. You could have made it out of a flat object and then pulled it up, as it were. But you'll see in a little bit why it's a good idea to create something, even something as relatively flat as toast, as a three-dimensional object and give it some three-dimensional variation. So it's just going to take a minute or so just to move these vertices around. Need to, as I say, make sure that we select all the vertices. So that's why I'm in wireframe mode, so that I can use C and select all the vertices in that vertical column. We're looking down on the toast at the moment. And then I'm just going to select that whole loop there and just pull it in a little bit. It doesn't have to be exact, but it's good if we can get fairly close to the edge of the, in this case, the toast, because there's obviously some variation in the way the toast browns towards the edge, and it's nice to pick that up in our shape. Just going around and around here, just take a few moments. Toast is one of the more straightforward things to do, but there are some little tricky elements to it, like this, the actual creation of the shape. And we are going to have to UV unwrap the whole shape in a moment. I'm going to add a subsurf modifier so these sharp edges will disappear. And then just pull this out here. Pull these out. You can see it's quite a big piece of toast vertically. It's probably more like a loaf of bread at the moment. And you see I've pulled those out there to sort of represent that bit of the toast that came out. There's of course many different ways of modelling. This is only one of them. Whatever you feel comfortable with or whatever you want to try at that time. So selecting just these last few vertices. We obviously don't want the plate showing through on the toast, and certainly when you do it yourself you can take a lot longer over it than I am. There's a few little bits I haven't quite tidied up there, but it's fine for this demonstration. And that's pretty close, apart from being very very thick, half a loaf. So we'll just cut that down on the z-axis now, so just scaling S, Z, and just getting the proportion somewhere around what I think it should be, so that's reasonably close to the shape of the toast. So we need to unwrap that and then apply the texture. So go into edit mode, make sure all the vertices are selected, project from view, bounds. Probably didn't need to do bounds, nevertheless. So now have a look at where that's mapped onto our UV image. Change the image to the toast, which is that one. And then we need to scale it down and plonk it on top of a piece of toast. Not entirely sure which way up it is, so we'll try this way to start with. I think that might be upside down, so we'll rotate again and see what that looks like. But let's just drop it on top first of all. Yeah, I think that is upside down. So we just rotate again, 180. And scale it in slightly. And we can pull even in here some of the vertices around with or without proportional editing on. I like to do those edge bits to get some of those sesame seeds in, just adds a little bit of interest to the image. Obviously this isn't changing the actual shape of the toast that's on the left. All this is doing is changing what is mapped to that, so you've got to be careful not to get too far away from your original shape, because if you do you will find the image is stretched and distorted. It is stretched and distorted, but beyond a certain point it'll become visible. Now at the moment it's just a blank piece of toast because we haven't actually applied the texture to the toast. So on the right hand side I've got a diffuse image selected. For this I could do a bump map as well. I'm not going to worry too much about that, so we'll just add an image texture and we'll select the toast. And we'll turn our lights on so we can see it better. That's not bad. There is an issue with it, but it's not bad. It's obviously we haven't added the subsurf yet, which is why we've got those sharp edges. So I'll just add that now. Turn that up a level. There we go. So that's at a glance you take that for a piece of toast, but there is an issue with it. And if we look at this edge down here, we can see it. And that's because of the way we unwrapped it. That all those vertices on that edge are getting the same part of the image, which is why it stretches down like that. So what we need to do is alter the shape slightly and then remap it. You could of course properly unwrap it so that you have a different texture wrapped around the edge, or a different part of the texture wrapped around the edge, but for something like this it is possible to cheat a little bit because of the way toast, certainly this toast, has tended to work. You can see it's sort of skewed slightly. What we can do is select these edges. And frankly, a lot of 3D rendering and graphics is about cheating. And I'm using proportional editing. And I'm just going to shrink that surface or part of the surface texture in order to pull that edge so that it can be seen from above. And then what will happen is I will select the whole thing and will UV unwrap, looking down on it again, projecting from view, but this time that edge is visible from the top, and so it will actually pick up some texture rather than everything having the same part of the image. So mesh, UV unwrap, project from view, and just select it all and scale it up. Push it over to the toast. Make sure we've got enough of those little seeds. And nothing will change, obviously, until we come out of edit mode and look at it in rendered mode, or at least material mode. And let's have a look at the rendered version now. If we zoom in on that edge, and you can now see we've actually got toast texture there now. And we've even got some seeds on the edge. It's not all dragged along the edge. It's not perfect. There's a few issues there, but it's fine for the tutorial. And obviously, again, you can take a little bit longer. So bringing in that with the rest of the scene, we can start to see that the proportions are okay. Just make it a little bigger, put it on the plate, drop it down a little bit. We'll just give it a bit of a color so that we can recognize that it's something different in the scene. Doesn't really matter what the color is. And just make it look as though it's really on the plate. Getting a bit of rotation in there so it's just perched on the rim. Saving that and give that a render. I think that's looking pretty fair. It's fairly convincing as a piece of toast now. You certainly wouldn't, at a glance, take it for anything else. And as I say, you can take a bit longer over it and get the texture right all the way around it. And as I say, the lights and things will do toward the end. The full lights is just my basic lights, just for illuminating the scene while I'm rendering. So we're now going to add that toast into the main part of the scene and then start to create the newspaper. So we need to just scale that up a little bit. And we're going to unwrap it. We'll need to add some extra vertices as well in order for us to be able to fold it. We need an odd number of vertices so that there's a center line. I suppose you could probably try and do it without that, but it'd be quite tricky. So I'm going to try 5. No, that's not quite enough. We've got our center line there, but I don't think there's really enough there to give us a curve, so we'll try 7. I think we'll go with 9. So that's now enough for us to be able to fold the paper in half, which again just gives that extra little something with the folding. So this is a little bit of a tricky thing, but before we go too much further, we're going to add our texture. You may have missed me UV unwrapping it. It was just a straightforward UV unwrap from the top down view. And we just turned some lights on. Any of you able to see it better? And there we go. It's a very bright white paper, so I'm going to change the texture slightly. I'm going to use the newsprint as a control for the color of the paper, and you'll see why as we do it. So again, into the node editor and stretch things out a little bit to give us some room. So we've got the image feeding into a diffuse texture which feeds into the material output. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add another diffuse node. See, I've got a color there. I want to give the paper a little bit of sort of yellowish color. So I'll duplicate the diffuse node, and the duplicate will have a near black color on it, and then the whiter node will have a yellowish color to it. and I need to use the image texture to control which colour we use. So I'll add now a mix shader, which we'll put up there. One side's the light colour, one side's the dark. If I'm all over in one, it goes dark. If it's over at zero, it uses the upper node. And then I use my image as the factor. And that's sort of working, apart from being the wrong way round. So you might think, just to fix that, I just invert it. So one way of doing that, I think there is an inverter in there somewhere, but you could just add a math node. Set it to multiply and set it to -1. Now that will work, but it's not ideal. As you can see, the text is very faint, so I then need to add a multiplier to multiply it up, as it were, to give us more variation. So rather than that way, I think the better way of doing this is to add a color ramp. And this gives us a lot more control in one node. So we plug that in, and there's our inverted text. Now if we swap these two points over, you can see that inverts it straight away. And also, we can control the contrast a lot more. So if these points are far apart, we get a lot of shades. If they're close together, we get a really black and white sort of text. It's one shade or it's the other. One bit, I suppose. So I'm just playing around with this, and by moving where, if you like, the center point of the two points in that curve are on that color ramp, I can shift the image to brighter or darker. And selecting different options in there selects what kind of curve is used to shade from one color on the left to the other on the right. So that's not bad. That's giving me, I don't want it absolutely black because newsprint isn't. I don't want it completely light. But you'll notice we're able to select the brightness of both the ink and the paper itself and the colour of it. So we now need to start to fold it. This is a bit tricky. Some of the problems with it will be taken out by the subdivision surface that we add to it, but before we can do that, we've got to get the fold in it. So we can use various different ways. We'll need to use proportional editing in order to change the way it works. I'm going to try first of all using the 3D cursor as my pivot point, and then we'll see what that starts to look like. What we've got to be careful of is stretching. So at the moment that's just a flat fold. So that's really not what we want. We're getting a little bit of curve on there, but it's not curving on both sides. It's not curving, it's just not quite what I want. So we'll go back to standard median point. And still with the proportional modifier on, we'll try again. Now that's starting to do what I want, but you'll notice it stretched it quite a lot from where it was originally. And that's really not ideal. So what I'll have to do after is take that stretching out. So it's a matter of just moving it around. There will be various ways of doing this. You could just build this as a curve to start with, as if it were an edge, a Bezier curve on an edge, and then stretch it up. And then UV unwrap that, but again, you'd then have to play around with it. There's many different ways of doing it. It's just whatever you want to do at the time. This was quite fun to do, and it sort of gives you some variation, some randomness as well, and a lot of different options. It looks like a mess, but we'll correct those in a moment. By no means is this necessarily the best way to do it, it's simply a way to do it. So you can see we've got that big stretched area underneath. Not that that matters too much, because we won't be able to see that. So I'm now just going to move things around a little bit. I think I'm going to need to turn that proportional modification off. And there you go. So now just start to bring that edge in a little bit. I'm thinking in terms of what this is going to look like once the subdivision surface is on there. So it's going to take these angular points and move them around. So just selecting some of the vertices here just so I can move them around and reduce that stretching. As long as it's not too extreme, it shouldn't be too much of a problem. It's only really that top surface I've got to be very careful with. I'm moving it around so that we can start to get the sort of shape that I wanted. Really, it's to represent obviously a folded newspaper, so I need to reduce it on the Z a little bit. Bring that in, and you can see most of the stretching is disappearing now. Got a bit of a stretch there, and it's flatter on the bottom side than on the top, which was part of the point, because obviously it's supposed to be resting on a surface. And I'm not going to completely fill it in, because I'm going to put more layers of paper inside. So you just need to bring that edge in a little bit. Okay, so we'll add the subsurf back, we'll save it first. I've just remembered I need to come out of GPU compute for this, because the texture I've used on here is very large and can cause my graphics card to crash. It doesn't have enough memory really. So it just means that the preview rendering will take a lot longer. When I do the formal render, there's no problem, because you can subdivide the scene and render a block at a time. So that's added that. I'll put it into smooth, and we can obviously correct those rounded corners if we want to. I'll just move a few of these vertices around a little bit to emphasize the shape, as though it's a fairly new newspaper flopped over and flattened on a table. Again, artistic license, as with most of these things. So that's not bad. And we can correct those rounded corners just by adding some extra loops. We'll add one there, one there, and one there. Not the way we should be able to see those edges, but that's that. So that's the basic leaf, as it were, of newspaper. Let's turn the lights on. I think it's backwards, but I'm not going to worry about that here. You can obviously turn the texture around in the UV image editor. It gives you the general idea. And what we now need to do is duplicate that and add some more layers going inward. So Shift D to duplicate it, and then rescale it, but not on the Y axis. Don't mind about it being rescaled on the Z axis or the X axis, because we're not going to see the left-hand side of it anyway, and then just push it around a little bit till it's about where I want it. Scaling it a little bit further on the Z, and just positioning it. And then doing it and repeating it. So I'll do that again. I want to keep the alignment, obviously, in the Y-axis, which is why I'm not scaling on the Y-axis. I just want it to get smaller as it goes in. Obviously, that's not realistic in terms of what really happens with paper. But because we're not seeing the left-hand edge, it's certainly an easier way to do it. It makes it representative. But again, you could have just made the curves at the edge with a Bezier curve and rendered it up, drawn it up from there. What I've just done is I selected the three or four leaves of paper that I'd made there, duplicated them all, and then pushed them in. But it's only a subtle effect, but it's quite effective, I think. And so we'll save that in case it crashes. And we'll have a look what that looks like. It's taking longer to render now, of course, because I'm in CPU rendering mode. But yeah, you can see there what appears to be multiple layers of paper. And to me, that's pretty convincing. So all we now need to do is just pull that into our main scene, and obviously to set the scale. So it's a bit big on the Y-axis there, actually. So that's another reason why it's good to put these things into another layer, at least at first. And I'm going to keep this in its own layer, because it can be handy to have this elsewhere, but just get the size of it about right. Bring it up, push it up there, and we'll put a bit of rotation on it as well. So I get it about where I want it and rotate it in the z-axis, sort of echoing the, or complementing the angle of the spoon there. I'm not going to get that exactly perfect right now. And then we'll move it to its own layer off over here so that I can have it in the scene if I want it, but not when I don't, for example, when I'm doing GPU computes. So we'll save that. And the last thing we'll do is just the lemon that's in the tea, and then we'll call it done for this part of the tutorial. So the little bit of lemon is another flat object, so that's pretty straightforward to do. We just need to create a little mesh circle. We'll get rid of our background image first, I think. And then add mesh circle. I use these a lot, as you can see. Go into edit mode, extrude, make sure we just scale inwards once we've extruded, and then extrude again, scale quite a long way in, stopping just before we get to the middle, extrude again, and then Alt-M at center, select all the vertices, extrude again, and this time just extrude upwards slightly. And that's not too bad. Go to smooth shading. Slight strangeness about the edges there, possibly. So I'll just check that the normals, which is where the edges, the faces face or the vertices are pointing, are okay. Yeah, all those little lines are telling me that none of them are pointing inwards, so that's okay. It's just to do with the way the smooth shading's working on the edge there. And now we need to just decide how we're going to unwrap that. I'm just going to add a few loops in here. Not strictly necessary, but can be useful if you ever want to change the surface at all. So that's about it for a very simple little disc. What I'm going to do is add a seam here so that we can unwrap it. I don't think I did this with the first one. But I'll mark that seam, and then we'll select this loop and we'll mark that. So this is to do with how we unwrap it. And then select this seam down here and mark that. Again, we're probably never going to see the other side, so I probably don't need to do it. But again, I might want to use this slice of lemon in something else, so it's handy to have it all complete, as it were. I'm just going to call up my image, so opening my images, go to my textures. It's not under food, it is under nature and fruit, and there we go, so we'll use that. And then we'll select all of our vertices and unwrap. That's quite clear. This row along here, that is obviously the outside of the lemon. I'll just use a very simple texture for that for now, because you're not really going to see it. And then I'll use obviously the image texture for the main part of the lemon that you do see. So I've accidentally grabbed a few extra vertices there, so I'll just use a different way of selecting those and just move that up out of the way. I'll just map in a different set of textures for that. Control shift and alt shift, and then select those, and then select all of that. And all I'm going to do now is just put those vertices on top of that set, because they're obviously going to take the same shape. Box select them all, move them over to the middle of the image, and then scale it up so that we can just begin to get the rind of the lemon there. So that'll do for the UV unwrapping. So we just need to apply some textures to this now. So just add a lemon material. We'll make this a mixed shader, so that we can have a diffuse shader for the lemon itself, and a shiny texture for the highlights. The edger has not worked, but that's because we didn't put anything on that. That's just got a white texture on it. I've added a subsurf modifier. It looks like a sort of strange plastic lemon slice at the moment. It's interesting, but it's not quite what we're looking for yet. But we'll sort some of that out in a moment. So to start with, I'm going to add a couple of vertices to sharpen those edges up. So one there, a couple of loops rather, one there and one there. And then we're going to select the rings, the loops around the edge, and we're going to put a different texture on those. So we'll add a new texture, and we'll call this lemon rind. Basically, it's a diffuse texture that's yellowish. And assign that. And let's have a look what we've got now. Yeah, just darken it a bit, I think. Starting to get there. I think we'll add diffuse texture again and a glossy texture because we may want to put a bit of shine on it as well. And obviously what you do is probably put an image texture around there or just use bump maps and noise and things like that to give you a rind effect. But we'll go into the node editor again, getting lots of experience on that today. And we'll see what we can do to improve the look of that central part. Because it looks almost like it's frozen in a block of ice or something like that at the moment. It's so flat. Let's select the main lemon texture. And come round and we'll put the image texture into the displacement. And it's not quite what we're looking for, but it's you can see it's affecting it in the right sort of way. We'll put a colour ramp on and we'll drop that in there. And we'll start to play around with that a little bit. We'll try inverting it, I think. And I think that's probably the right direction. It's a bit extreme at the moment, but it's actually giving us some shape to the surface of that lemon slice, which is good. Gives us a few highlights. So we'll add a math node now. Set it to multiply. And then just use that to reduce the intensity of that bump a little bit. It's one of the great things about cycles, the ease that you can do this with. And then we'll just play around with some of the glossy values just to get that a little better. Having higher roughness gives you more specular reflection, but that can sometimes look a little strange, especially with something like this where I'm trying to make it look as though it's wet because it's going to be having tea poured over it. It's fairly shiny, and now I'm just playing around with the amount that the glossy shows through. It's just balancing those two things. It's very shiny now, very reflective. I'll reduce the amount of that comes through so that there's plenty of colour and not so much reflected light. That's about right. That'll do for now, I think. So that's our slice of lemon. And we can put that into our main scene now. And we just need to put that somewhere in the cup. And I put a small angle on it, that's because the tea is being poured into the cup, so obviously it would make the floating lemon move around a little bit. So that's about it for this lesson. If you've got any questions, just let me know. We've got the teapot spout and the tea left to do, which will be pouring into there, so there's a fluid simulation to do. But other than that, and the lighting, that's basically it. So I'll just give that a bit of a render so that we can see what that's starting to look like. Obviously the tea and the teapot's not there, and as I say, we've got some work to do with the lighting, but that seems to be coming on. much slower because I put it onto CPU render. So if you've got any questions or comments, just leave a message below. Otherwise, I'll see you in part 3, which will hopefully be the final part of the render. Thanks a lot.